seem to comment a lot about that there's nothing to worry about Fukushima, and you know, they seem to be have no shortage of raising funds from places, unlike the rest of us who have to do sort of menial editing and all kinds of technical writing. That's not very exciting.
Any names, but some. Faculty member at a university in Canada probably doesn't have to worry about money too much. Some people in Woods Hole probably don't have to worry about money too much.
And even some so-called anti-nuclear activists who,
they are among the worst.
Trashed Dana Durnford and hope he goes to jail sort of situation. And they have too many problems putting out a lot of websites, a lot of video stuff.
I'm
more familiar with your site, which is a real struggle, I know, a brave handful there, working very hard for probably sub-minimal pay.
It's by the time you get all the tax done, it's, and they said when you subtract operating costs, there's not much left. That's a joke.
That's right. And there is price inflation that,
absolutely.
The government doesn't claim exists.
People don't understand.
It's tough.
Now, I want to congratulate you and thank you for the article that you wrote about Dana's plight. It's extraordinary. It's right up there at the top of updates.
Yeah.
Fukushima's political fallout puts anti-nuke researcher on trial. Please read that. Support Dana Durnford, who I hope is standing by. We'll get to him. Are you there, Dana?
Yeah, I'm here, but I don't know if my mic is working.
Yeah, it's working fine.
Good to hear from you, Dana. Hope your spirits are up.
Day after reading your article, Yoshi, that was wonderful, my friend. Just absolutely amazing. Everybody sent it to me. It's moving around all over the net. Really, 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 truly made a difference, big time.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. Although, it's nothing extraordinary. It's just a presentation of the simple facts that you turned up out of the ocean.
Yeah,
it's just simple facts, the truth that we've been living with. And since I've known you, Dana, for the last couple of years, it's not nothing extraordinary. Just what we do. And
it's
like the roof's coming down, right? It's like the courts are interfering. And then as we dig around, we're finding out that, it's not just Canada's involved. We got the whole darn Pentagon, the weight of the Pentagon behind it. And we're finding out a lot of ugly...
Very ugly. Very ugly things.
...aspects about your accusers. Ken Buesler, this would really shock me, that Ken Buesler's first trip out there after Fukushima was funded by the Naval Research Lab, the U.S. Navy. And why did the U.S. Navy send out a team after that? Because they knew darn well that the entire crew of the Ronald Reagan, an aircraft carrier, more than 2,000 U.S. servicemen had been exposed to serious levels of radiation, plutonium, when they're out there in Operation Tomodachi trying to help the Japanese people who were hit by the tsunami. They were gathering some sort of fake data to try to basically get rid of the Ronald Reagan sailors.
That was the first stage of the cover-up. You're right.
Yes. Ken Buesler was there on a Navy grant to be out there with Navy personnel.
Yeah.
I mean, this is like we've heard of Gulf War Syndrome. We've heard of Agent Orange affecting U.S. veterans and so on, But to hear that less than a year after Fukushima, they sent out a team from the Naval Research Lab, from their Navy scientists were sent out there to do in more than 2,000 U.S. sailors who were there to help the Japanese people. That, to me, is beyond
that's
treason.
Where the Reagan cover-up...
It's so morally unacceptable,
That was the Reagan cover-up, the beginning of the full effort to hide, and it didn't last. You got dead people now.
Until
your case, Dana, until we started digging around who Ken Buesler was. We didn't realize that. We just thought he was just a relatively honest scientist with a little bit of bias that was very cautious and conservative and didn't want to stick his neck out and was, living off of National Science Foundation grants. We didn't realize he's with the U.S. Navy, and he was part of this cover-up to basically kill off the members of the Reagan, deny them medical care, and just get rid of them.
Typical veterans
the same thing
treatment.
Petco is doing to the residents of Fukushima.
That's
the exact
right.
Same thing.
Same thing.
Want to get rid of any survivors so that there's no evidence left and there's no testimony.
We should
just
point
like
out that. Let me point out, Yoshi, that. I don't want to put Dana on the spot and have him say anything that's going to get him
that's
in trouble.
Right.
So
that's,
we'll do the talking.
Right.
We're not involved with Canadian law.
That's right.
So that's why the article's written. Dana, go ahead.
I can't confirm or deny anything, so on that side of it. But I am heading down tomorrow to my second court appearance. And so after reading that article, Yoshi, you know, it's just so many ideas and there's so much documentation there. I think personally that that was totally brilliant because they got no way of defending anything you said there. And it just lays out the case for any lawyer or any judge. And it kind of goes further than anything I might have said. And, you know, like all I really do sometimes is I get excited, but I overemphasize things. I get excited in order to try to get some attention. It's salacious what I do. You know, it's the equivalent of stopping traffic on a highway, getting out on the roof and screaming what this issue is and getting arrested for it, but finally getting some attention for it. That's really all I'm doing. I'm so looking forward to going down there and dealing with these people. I can't wait to get them on the stand. I can't wait for them to get me on the stand. I can't wait for the judge or the jury to hear the video in full. I mean, they only took a little tiny sound bite and used that against me without no pictures or no contexts or no sentences before or after. But 1 hour presentation, I managed to get a judge to sign away my freedoms on that. And yeah, so your article is the first thing I'm showing lawyers and judges, and I still haven't been able to get a lawyer.
You're still looking for a lawyer.
Isn't this so sad that the legal community knows that there's a force of power in this case? In other words, any other time, of course, people would jump forward to do pro bono or, you know, give you a very reduced fee to be in the news and all that. Any lawyer will want to do that.
Right.
They've all been warned.
Yeah, it seems
that
way.
National security issue. Dana Durnford is a threat to the national security of the United States of America. Never mind Canada. This has nothing to do with Canada. This has
they
to
don't
do
want
with
their
the
children
Pentagon.
Listening to me. They want their friends to hear me, or you, or Jeff, or anybody else for that matter. And that's the reality.
So
and
this is the problem. The legal community's got to stand up for your rights, your human rights, your civil rights, your right to a fair trial, and a right to face your accusers.
Well, because they're standing up for their own, for God's sakes.
Yeah.
He should have pro bono attorneys lined up right now.
Yeah. Absolutely.
But they're all running scared. That's the only possible answer.
Yeah, where is the ACLU
answer?
When you need them?
Oh.
Yeah, where is the ACLU when you need them? You know?
Right.
This is so ridiculous. This is so black and white a case of, I call it Inquisition.
It is an Inquisition. Sure it is.
Yeah. It's everything that justice is not. It's everything that law is not. And where is the rule of law? Completely absent.
It's a circus. I mean, we are talking about an extinction event. This is not just somebody yelled at somebody else. This is, you know, built up over a 2-year period. This has climaxed, literally reached its pinnacle of everything I can do. I don't know what else to do, but I'll continue to do things. Don't get me wrong. But, I mean, I've done everything I could do, and I become so outrageous and so landish and so flamboyant trying to get that message out there that I finally got the attention. I finally got them to recognize that I exist. I finally got them to make that first move and drag this into the open sphere. To me, you know, I feel good about it. I don't like what they're doing to me. Don't get me wrong. I'm not looking forward to going down there, but I'm looking forward to seeing them. I'm looking forward to dealing with it. I'm looking forward to being able to approach this, hopefully, on record.
Well, when you get the two men, the primaries, on the stand, I would pay money to see you look them in the eye and to see if they can hold your gaze. They know. They know.
As they play the video that begins this whole thing, they're going to know. And by the time you get to that section, you still got to watch the rest of the video. And by the time you got to the end of that video, how can you deny what's really going on? And so their entire case falls apart the minute that we put that video out there. And I mean, it'd be a dream come true to get them on the stand. It'd be a dream come true to make them explain their crazy voodoo science that they're talking about, because it's not in the literature. And we all know that it doesn't matter who it is. These are just the two subjects in particular. But I mean, there's all of these other people that I've called out doing the exact same thing. Right. It just happens to be a couple of people got all the traction in North America. And who are you supposed to yell at? That if that's the only couple of people. Well, I mean, Woods Hole, 850 scientists, no nuclear scientist steps forward. Canada, 25 nuclear reactors, no nuclear scientists step forward. And so that's going to make people frustrated anyway. And particularly it's like yourself, who knows really well the difference in what they're saying. All I really done was nothing. I can't see why they went and done it this way.
It's stupid. It's arrogant. It's stupid. It's maniacal. Here you are out on your 21-foot rubber boat with a wood top over it in howling gales in 14, 15-foot seas, trying to record and document what they should be rushing to do. You're the hero, and they are trying to make you out to be the opposite. It's going to blow up in their face. This is because science is science, facts are facts, and their efforts to twist and corrupt are not going to stand.
And the pictures you got on your site, it tells the story. There to before, but right there of anywhere in British Columbia, those pictures are true. For every piece of British Columbia, no matter where you're to, they're true. And so it's not about the picture in the exact spot, because even though they are, it's about these species were uniform throughout the coastline, and that if those species went missing, science says the other 4 million will fill up the gap. And they didn't fill up the gap, but they didn't recede the coastline. And so that means truly that ocean is devastated.
What happened in Oregon last week, a blue whale washed up dead on the shore. What was the condition of the blue whale? Emaciated, it had literally starved to death. No more food in the Pacific Ocean.
And Yoshi covered that really good a number of videos back, where he said, how come Japan's not checking the whales? Because they love the whales. And you took them right to task on it. How come we're not seeing any researchers go full tilt on the whales? It is an interesting thing, because they're dependent upon the krill. The majorities are on, most of their diet is krill. Most of those sea lions and pups, the tens of thousands that died, were dependent upon the krill. They starved to death. They came on the beaches and ate the rocks, hoping to suck some nutrition from. Normally there would be, you know, 5 or 6,000 species on those rocks.
Well, they only starved to death, but they bioaccumulated radiation to death as well.
Oh yeah. It affects the fetus is really heavy.
It's all sickening. It's just horrible. Well, bravo, Canada, for being so stupid. You're going to give this a platform, and the truth will come out. It's already out. It's going to be elevated now to a major level in the media. I don't care if the media covers it up there. We'll cover it.
You got that right, Jeff. I mean, you know, there's a lot more detail we're turning up about what's really going on. You know, the military technology work, the connections of these people, the corruption, Tokyo Electric Power about to export uranium out of the port of Vancouver. It's going to contaminate all of Western Canada already. Nuclear accident inside the port of Vancouver in the year 2011 was not picked up by the press. There's a lot of stuff that hasn't been reported. The public doesn't know about. When the public finds out the full extent of the secrecy, the connivory, the lying, and the destruction all around them, there's going to be hell to pay.
All right. Let me remind you that you can find the latest stories that I can get, and I've got pretty good sources. Look in the center column. In the news section, the news headlines, 24/7, right at the top, latest Fukushima updates are there. You folks, I ran into someone the other day, I can't remember who it was, and I said, do you eat, who was it? Anyway, I don't remember. But I asked someone, and they, I love fish. Oh, I love fish. I said, do you eat fish from the Pacific? Oh, yes. Well, my first question was going to be, well, where did you get it? There aren't any left. But then I just skipped to the point. I said, hey, don't you know? Don't you understand that you can't eat anything out of the Pacific Ocean anymore? What do you mean? And I said, just look up Fukushima. And that was it. It was just a quick statement. And they won't. And they'll keep eating it. You got seafood restaurant chains that are, you know, they know, but they're not slowing down. Sushi restaurants, not slowing down. And I hear business is great.
Well, Jeff, you know, the government of South Korea has already seized 6 million pounds of radioactive contaminated fish. And a lot of that fish, you know, the Japanese fish, most of the fish from the West Coast, from the Pacific Northwest, from Canada, Alaska, is shipped to Japan. So we're talking about the Korean government has basically got a blanket rule. Basically, Japanese fish cannot come into Korea because it is too dirty, it's too contaminated. So what's happening now is all flooding back in the United States from Japan. And the Taiwanese government stopping it, the Chinese government stops it. The Thai government is so-so, but it's pouring into Thailand because they're, you know, they're very corrupted down in Thailand.
Yeah. Wow. All right. And keep in mind that, look at the third story there. There is this is for our listeners who may be new. They're expecting 1 million cancer deaths in Japan. I would say it's going to be multiple millions, not just one. I think that's just a conservative, comfortable number for them to swing around. It's bad enough. But the issue, of course, is one of there is no safe dose of radiation because it accumulates. It's like x-rays. You don't want to get too many x-rays. It all accumulates. So here we are. Read. Just read. It's all there for you. We put it up. Yoshi's article is extraordinarily important. I can't overstate that.
It is.
It's essential.
It's really something. Really something. Everybody sent it to me. We're just totally ecstatic. I was talking to you before about how the bears out here are only eating apples. I'm sure you guys remember that.
Because tell our listeners.
The snow is gone from the mountains.
Tell our listeners again why.
Well, the snow is gone from the mountains in British Columbia because of the tritium.
It's the first time.
It doesn't
folks.
Allow the ice to crystallize, like Yoshi pointed out a while back. Go ahead, Jeff. I'm sorry.
No, it's the first time there's no snowpack.
Right. We've never seen that in the history of the human race here. We have no records of it. And it's gone symmetrically throughout the entire coastline. It's all mountains along that coastline, 26,000 islands in the backgrounds, all mountains covered in blue ice and snow on the top. And so that would cool down the rivers and the lakes and the estuaries.
Right.
And so now the salmon can't get up the river. Now, my kid, he does a species count out here every week with three other guys. He's the guide. And sometimes he's the contractor. He's also a skipper. He'll take fisheries and oceans out, scientists, and do tests. Yeah. And he's been doing it for many years now. But he's always taking a gun. He's the guy with the gun. And he put down a bear a few days back. The bear, normally they encounter bears all the time. This bear was in the river. There's no salmon in the river. That's what they were doing, was a species count of the salmon. And the bear put his head down. And instead of running away, it put its head down and started coming towards them. And they never had any those firecrackers to throw at them. All they had that time was the bear spray. And so the bear was definitely moving in on him. And he didn't want to shoot him, but he ended up having to shoot to kill the bear. But the bear was underweight. The bear wasn't able to get anything out of the river. There was some salmon down on the coastline trying to get up the river. But once again, there was no water in the mountains. They couldn't get up that river. And so we're going to see a lot more of these animals doing stuff like this. We had an attack here.
Strange behavior going on.
Attack here a couple months ago. In town. But once again, I'll just finish on that part, is that all the beer have been eating for the last month or so was the apples that were left over. The berries failed this year. There was no fish in the river. And, of course, because the rivers are so low, I'll end it on that, is that there will be no salmon coming back because they didn't get up and lay eggs. And it's not going to change. It took thousands of years to build the ice on that mountains, and the tritium now has destroyed it. And
we'll the bears, a lot of them are not going to make it through hibernation, I'll bet.
Yeah, there's a lot of animals missing on along here for the hunters we're talking about. They can't find anything. And the bears seems to be in the communities. I know a month or so ago, a month and a half ago, there was over 50 in just a few days all over the area here. And many of them got end up getting shot and captured. So they're really desperate. They've never seen them like that before.
Wow.
Also, you know, last week after being arrested, the PR, nuclear PR firms watched one of my videos, allegedly phoned the police up and said I was suicidal, and the police showed up at my house on Wednesday.
Excuse me.
Yeah, but they were really good. They were nice people. They told me right away I wasn't under arrest or anything like that. I mean, they went away when I asked them. There was no headache.
They just did a welfare check because
somebody. But they had to come down and check because the same police officer who filed the charges against me was the guy who ended up phoning the detachment here, and the police come down to check and see if that was so. And
the same guy called in and said you were suicidal.
Yeah, that he got a message from somebody is all he said. And I said to the police, did you watch the video? And I said, I never posted no video in the last number of days. So it wasn't me. But I don't know what they're talking about. He said he never watched the video. And that was the end of that. Now, I took his card, of course.
We're going to go through the break, Todd. Yeah, go ahead, Dana. Go ahead.
And then the next day, they phoned me again around 7 o'clock at night and told me to take down a video of the 150 melon-head whales that died in Japan. And Yoshi covered that really well. I had to take down that video, but that was breaking my probation. I got 12 different probation rules against me. And then the next day, the money wouldn't go into my account, my bank account, the same system I've been using to fund 5 expeditions. And so I'm still struggling with that. But I got to head down tomorrow, which is okay, but I'll get it when I come back. But so far, yeah, these guys are at me constantly, and all the strikes on my YouTube account means I couldn't live stream no more. And so they really greased me over. They'd done that when I got out of jail and got home. And to me, it's laughable, but, you know, it's like they're really working me over for some reason. But why didn't they get fingerprints off me? Why didn't they come and pick me up on Sunday when the warrant was issued? Why did they wait till the night before the judge showed up here? If I was a threat, why did he wait when the videos were made in July and October early? Why did he wait until November? You know, there's all these really weird things that are going on. And I can't see how they can possibly hope to win the case. They have already perverted justice by filing those charges against me. They're totally erroneous. And it's totally out of context to take a 8-second clip, type it out, and claim that that's evidence without any context of a 1-hour video for my defense, and that I was locked up in a box, wasn't even able to talk to the judge. I mean, all of these things don't make sense unless you're trying to set you up or something.
Well, you're up against a nuclear power industry is what this is all about, ultimately.
And then all the blowback on the internet from everybody being articulating, and then Yoshi coming out with the cream of the crop, really laying it out. And he's been Yoshi, you know, you're a science journalist, carries a lot of weight. Trust me, that carries a lot of weight. Everybody notices that right away. And, you know, I'm just so grateful for what everybody has done, what you have done yourself. And those pictures on your site, they hurt me. But they're necessary. And I have to look at it too. But I hate looking at it with a passion, because I can't do things properly for a long time after. It takes hours for me to come down off that. And I get angry when I look at the pictures. And that's what drives me all the time, is that I know better. And anybody looks up a picture of British Columbia coastline, they'll find the same pictures.
Well, we need, and all of you people who are listening who live in British Columbia now, who may live along the coast or have people along the coast, do your own research, read, understand, and reach out and help Dana. He doesn't have a lawyer yet. He's going to need some money. If there's a lawyer with a spine left in Canada, he needs to step forward. He may get hurt, but he's got higher principles, let's hope, and not just a mortgage and a couple of kids. There are more issues involved here than that. And you got to have somebody who's righteous, who will step up and support you. This is what we need to happen. And the people who live along the coast, they got to tell it too.
I think it's all going to come out. And I think that, you know, I can call on Yoshi for an expert witness and a number of other people out there. There's no way they can win the case against me without...
I'm not sure they're even thinking about that. I think they know that. I think they're just trying to hassle you to make you stop. Yeah.
I ain't stopping.
No.
Well, Dana, make sure your friends, surveillance, small surveillance devices, cameras are pretty cheap now. Put them up all over the place. Nice hidden camera.
I do so.
You know, with those, the infrared types, and all around your house, your car, and so on. Try to get more of your friends, being there with you, getting out of things, because we just never know what these kind of folks are up to. You know, we just never know what they're really about. So, what kind of thugs they associate with, retired defense contractors, that sort of thing, policemen who've been fired from their jobs.
Anymore, since the lid came down, none of the workers there are talking.
The security lid there. Obviously, the two former prime ministers went north. Uh-huh. There's a new MOX fuel. It'll be an entirely new MOX fuel operation in the very northern tip of Honshu. Two prime ministers went up there to denounce that because they know the Shinzo Abe government is up to no good.
They're going They're going to build a new MOX plant? Or convert.
It'll be nothing but MOX fuel. And it's near Rokkasho, the big depository for plutonium that's coming back from France to process. So basically a very, very, very suspicious operation up in northern Japan that the two prime ministers went up there to a nearby city in Hokkaido, which would be within 30 kilometers if a reactor 3 type explosion occurs. That city has filed a case in Tokyo court to block that reactor based on the fact that, what happened to reactor 3, there's no way to control the MOX fuel. It has a bad record. So this is a new thing. Shinzo Abe is determined to extract plutonium for some nefarious reason, and then we can guess why. And so this new plan is scheduled to open next year.
I didn't know anything about this. More insanity.
Yeah, this is real skullduggery that's going on. This is militarist, total militarist, genocidal skullduggery that's been that's happening in Japan. They're not. The other news from Japan, that large south was much closer to that other operating nuclear plant, Sendai. USGS maps were doctored. Showed it. Google Maps doctored their map to show the earthquake epicenter be further away. The actual one, you can see on Fukushima Diary, is very, very close to those reactors. And the tsunami was hit by a small tsunami, but it's in the same earthquake and volcanic zone. These people are really playing dice with what's left of the future of humanity and life on Earth. And what can I say? Oh, the other thing I should just mention is when we talk about Jay Cullen's thesis that there's no cesium-137 out of Fukushima, that's already been disputed by Japanese, overturned by Japanese scientists, by Tokyo Electric Power itself that admits as well as CS-137.
Did he actually say that, Yoshi? He actually...
All of it comes from the atomic test back in the 60s and 70s.
Oh, my God.
Came from Fukushima. Oh. And so I urge everybody to read ENE News, the article from the Crystal River plant of Duke Power Company. And I don't know if people are aware of it, but Bob Nichols, Veterans Today, he explained that Duke Power was given these new MOX fuel rods by the Obama administration. They did a short test and shut it down and said, we can't control this stuff. We want nothing to do with these MOX fuel rods. And so Duke Power does not operate a plant anymore in Florida, near Tampa Bay. That was shut down in 2012. But it is reported they still have a monitoring team there for any residuals. They're saying cesium-137 is falling down periodically on a regular basis over the orange orchards of Florida.
In Florida.
Where you get your orange juice and grapefruits from? There's cesium-137 on the leaves and on the outside. And, I don't know.
Well, it's in the fruit. It's in the fruit. The story is up there.
Yeah, this is basically the orange growing district outside Texas.
That's right.
And, Yeah, and then Duke Power does have a monitoring station there, and they just said there's been lots of cesium-137 falling in Florida over the orange groves.
And where does cesium come from again, ladies and gentlemen? Come from Duke Power.
Duke is a major nuclear power company in the United States, and they're just saying this stuff's been coming since the Fukushima disaster. It is from Fukushima. They know about MOX fuel rods. They warned the Obama administration, Department of Energy, this stuff is too dangerous to handle. And then what happens? Reactor 3, Fukushima, blows up, and Duke Power is saying, we told you so, guys. We warned you. We're the experts. We know stuff that you guys don't know, and you still went ahead and loaded these MOX fuel rods in Fukushima, Department of Energy.
The article is up there at number two position. It says, it's official, Fukushima dumping radiation all over the U.S. from Duke Power, Duke Energy. Read it.
Duke Power. I mean, TEPCO is admitting it. Duke Power is admitting it. Jay Cullen, Ken Buesler are denying it. I mean, how blatant does it get?
Here, let me read a little bit. In 2011, there were positively measured benefits and results of iodine and cesium. Not benefits. There were positive. Let me do this again. In 2011, there were positively measured results of iodine and cesium. These measurements are a direct result of the Fukushima nuclear plants. The Japanese event also affected broad leaf vegetation sample media throughout the year as long-lived radionuclides, cesium-137, were released at Fukushima multiple times, says Duke Energy. Multiple times. The vegetation measurements in 2014 are still affected by the Fukushima event due to the long-lived radionuclides deposited. The vegetation control sample station located in Orlando, Florida, is also experiencing similar cesium-137 deposition on the broadleaf sample plant media. In 2014, 16 of 24 indicator vegetation samples, that's 16 of 24, had measurable amounts of cesium-137 to 139. The cesium-137 values are similar in concentration as compared to samples collected in 2013, which experienced radionuclide deposition as a result of the Fukushima earthquake event. So here's Duke Energy laying it out there, and yet the two most notoriously famous or well-known scientists, Jay Cullen and Ken Buesler, are saying it doesn't exist. So somebody's not telling the truth here, folks. You figure it out. Hold on, we'll be right back. Let's get back to this. Let me read this a little bit more to make sure I get as much out as I can to balance the story. In 2014, writes Duke, cesium-137 in grapefruit at a concentration of 4 picocuries per kilogram was found. It is not unusual to periodically see cesium-137 in citrus samples due to widespread deposition of cesium-137 from fallout due to past weapons testing and more recently from the Fukushima earthquake and tsunami event. So Duke is being totally honest, all right? And what we have are scientists and others who are clinging to this past weapons mystique as being the answer. It's not the answer. Duke has a problem if these people are telling the truth. If they're not telling the truth, they have a problem. I'd like to see it resolved.
Dana, let's hear from you. How's everything else in your life besides this? Is there a life besides outside of this court case anymore?
No. I mean, just
want
to get
you're a pretty happy
understand.
Fellow. You like the ocean. You like the outdoors. Yeah. What are you doing in your pastime now that you're not on the rubber dinghy like you like to be? You enjoy. I finally realized it. You know, these horrible waves, the icy winds, the huge dangers, the spills you've had. You actually enjoy it. You know, the rest of us are worried about you, but you seem to thrive out there.
Like, I'm not going to lie that's who I am. That's my personality, and that I thrive in that environment. The worse it threw at me, the more work I seem to get done. The uglier it was,
the better you feel. It's amazing, huh?
I dressed up even better, and I just kept going. I didn't stop for nothing. I didn't care. And I would never come home till I was happy. I just wouldn't come home till I was like, I'm not coming home till I got it all done, because I might never get another opportunity to go up and do it.
I can't even imagine what you did. Crazy. I really can't. I mean, he's got video, folks, when he's out by himself in this 21-foot Zodiac, in the wind, in the rain, giant seas, and he's going up and down between these valleys and waves and peaks. And it was incredible. It's like a Hollywood film.
260 days, 15,000 miles. And we hit everything. We hit all the prime spots. I dove most of those spots commercially years ago.
Yeah.
And so, but it's been a long time, right? So, and not the same operation, not a $500,000 operation underneath you. You know, you don't have a whole fleet there ready to get you if something goes wrong. And you're by yourself. No one knows where you're to. And you know, it's the loneliest trip I've ever made, because there was no animals, no creatures, no insects,
No, usually you're comforted by the incredible life in the ocean, but it's gone. It's like that yachtsman who went all the way from Osaka to San Francisco and saw one bird, two fish, and a whale with a huge tumor on its head. He said the ocean is dead. And that was a year and a half ago or so.
It's 100% right, yeah.
Yeah. Here's the last sentence from that Duke press release. Broadleaf vegetation samples taken during 2014 with elevated cesium-137 levels are a direct result of the Fukushima earthquake and tsunami event that occurred in 2011. Period. Okay? It's all there. Duke is laying it out truthfully and honestly. There's your benchmark. That's your bedrock. Okay, good for Duke. Bravo.
Yeah, well, I mean, it is really good. I mean, I don't agree with the business they're doing, but I do agree with the fact that they're honest about what they're doing.
Absolutely.
And that is, well, this is the ethics we're talking about. We can have enormous life and death sort of disagreements, but we are going to be civil, we're going to be truthful, and we're going to operate within the law. And you know, these accusations of Dana are just totally spurious. You know, I'm sure that these guys have no problem inventing things that are far less into the opposite of truth about the basic science that they're supposed to be committed to. And I assume that same dishonesty is being carried over into these charges against Dana. So I just
hope no question
that the courts see through this, that the parliament members of the Parliament of Canada see through this. People in the Canadian government see through, people in the Canadian military see through this, and stand tall, you know, stand up for Canadian sovereignty, for the Canadian way of life, and don't cave in to these very dark, thuggish people, you know.
Meanwhile, what do we have? The Olympics. The Tokyo Radioactive Olympics, is there any serious move to relocate them to a safe venue?
Well, there is. I spoke to people in Kyoto, and they a lady who was the former sort of the godmother of the Diet, of the parliament. She was sort of like the whip, the parliament whip. She was absolutely ecstatic when I said, we've got to move it. She said, this Olympic is so rotten, it so stinks. Even if it wasn't radioactive, it should be moved. But the fact that Tokyo is radioactive, it has to be moved. The ambassador to Switzerland, former Ambassador Murata, has come out and said Tokyo should make a withdrawal from this Olympic and let it go elsewhere.
Good.
So that's huge. He's high-level fellow, you know, really in the top blue ribbon group there. Brian Victoria. A very, very respected scholar of Buddhism, Buddhist philosophy, lived in Tokyo, Kyoto, for decades. Mm-hmm. He's written letters, long letters to Japan Times, explaining why the Olympics should be withdrawn and that Ambassador Murata is right. So I think movement is going to be underway. radioactive. The water supply is very clear to Shinjuku, Tokyo, which is downtown. It's like the Manhattan of Tokyo. The water supply is radioactive there. Wow. And, you know, you can't avoid it. Athletes have to, even if they brought in bottled water, they're
no, they got a shower in it and everything, of course.
Yeah, you have to bathe, you have to shower, you have to wash your clothes in it. All of that's going to be radioactive. So it's urgent now. And the other problem is the gas works. They're trying to move the fish market, Tsukiji fish market, the radioactive fish market, out from the edge of Tokyo onto one of the islands near the Olympic site. They're finding all sorts of toxic chemicals there. The project is delayed. And then these islands are not very well built. They were, you know, they're built out of rubble. They're all leaking into the bay. I mean, the bay is completely toxic dead zone, and this is where the Olympics going to be held. So besides the radiation, you got chemical toxins, and the very famous aquarium is right there. It's right there out in the bay. All the tuna died there, in a couple of days. All the tuna fish, the 50 tuna fish they had on display, died because they pumped water from the bay, and that's filtered water.
Wow.
So there's no chance for this Olympics. It's a death zone. I wouldn't be surprised if athletes start just keeling over, coaches and athletes keel over if they practice out there in the outdoors.
Well, you got a problem of heart attacks, too.
Yeah. Heart attacks. One of the first things to go, I told you back in June after Fukushima,
yes,
my uncle died of a heart attack, and I strongly suspected then it was from Fukushima because he was otherwise in great health, and then suddenly something just turned off and he was dead. And then we've got to remember, since 2011, more people have died in Japan. Every year has been a record-setting year for the number of deaths in Japan, okay? Every year, instead of records on top of each other, people are dying already, and that's before the onset of the major cancer death. I think there'll be a diminishing of deaths for a while between the heart attacks and the cancer deaths as people are trying to get treatment for cancer. There'll be a valley there, but that valley is like, you know, before the storm, basically, of cancer. So
well,
this is a terrible time Japan faces. Terrible time.
All right. Well, we have a lot of people listening tonight, including probably Cullen and Buesler, among others. And gentlemen, you're both welcome to come on this program anytime you'd like.
Thank you.
That would be very interesting. We'll get Yoshi on here, and we'll have a little conference, see what you have to say.
I hear that one.
Yeah. So just let me know if you want to come on. You're more than welcome.
Well, Dana, good luck tomorrow. Keep your spirits up and your fighting spirit up and your commitment to truth, as always. We know we can depend on you, but I'm just saying that just to,
I need
to get you in there. That's all.
I think there'll be no more Olympics after this one. And I think they should have the Olympics in Chernobyl rather than Japan. It makes us a lot less radiation.
It's actually safer. It would be safer.
It
Chernobyl.
Would be.
That's what's so absurd. Yeah.
That's the absurdity of it, exactly. Oh, by the way, whatever happened to Operation Kelp Watch 2014? Gone.
Well, they got an ostrich.
There's nothing to watch. That's the problem. They're looking for the kelp. Yeah,
that's the truth.
It's all gone. The kelp is gone. There's nothing to watch anymore. Terrible. And this, one thing we must say, Jay Cullen does not operate in a vacuum. I want to say this to the students at the University of Victoria on Vancouver Island in British Columbia. There is something rotten at Vic, at UVic. And you've got to look around at what's happening in that ocean neglected department there. And see what they're actually up to and who's involved. We've already shown you what Woods Hole Oceanic Institute is all about, that it provides civilian cover for military purposes. Students, look for yourself. I don't have to say this to you. You look for yourself. What is wrong with your campus? And demand changes, demand reforms, and an honest scientific faculty.
Just demand the truth. For God's sake.
The truth and honest science. Science is based on honesty.
You should
not
become
lies and fabrication.
You should become the lead university in the world when it comes to examining and revealing and exposing the radiation from Fukushima.
That's what should happen. Proud of them instead of disgusted.
Absolutely. You got it. All right, Yoshi, take care.
Sure.
Dana, you take care of yourself. Good luck tomorrow. Let me know what happens.
Thank you. Good night, everybody.
Okay. Yoshi, I'll talk to you next week.
Great. Okay.
Okay, thanks. All right. That's our program tonight, and that's the latest. A lot of stuff happening. We will be back tomorrow evening. I hope you can join us as we continue to bring you up to date on the world and its grief.